Hello everyone, welcome back. This is the second lecture in the series of antifungal drugs. In our last lecture, we talked about the basic antifungal drugs. We talked about the fungal infections in Nepal, the mechanism of drug of action of various antifungal drugs, and the classification of antifungal drugs. We also talked about the various targets of antifungal drugs. So today we'll move on to talk about various classes of antifungal drugs. The azole antifungals, polyene antifungals, allyl amines, echinocandins, and various other antifungals and newer antifungal agents. So let us move on to talk about polyene antibiotics that constitutes of amphotericin B and nystatin.
Amphotericin is actually a polyene antifungal agent from Streptomyces maurusus, but it is not just amphotericin B that is there. Amphotericin A and B both are produced from Streptomyces nodosus. However, amphotericin A is not in clinical use, and we only talk about amphotericin B. And even amphotericin B, we said that in 1958, the first colloidal type of amphotericin B was found. Then the liposomal form of amphotericin B, like amphotericin B colloidal dispersion and amphotericin B lipid complex, they were discovered later on, right? They all are in clinical use now. Let us have a look at the mechanism of action of the drug. Amphotericin B, this is a selective in its fungicidal effects. It binds to ergosterol, which is a membrane sterol found in the cell membrane of the fungi, like the bacteria and human, which have got cholesterol in them, right? It increases the permeability of the cell by forming amphotericin B associated pores. And via these pores, what is going to happen is that there is going to be leakage of intracellular ions and macromolecules, and because of the leakage of the intracellular ions and macromolecules and also added oxidative damage to the fungal cells, they are going to either kill or inhibit the growth of the fungals depending upon the organism and the concentration of the drug. This has got a relatively broad spectrum of activity, and it has got fungicidal action in most of the cases. So amphotericin B remains the drug of choice for nearly all life-threatening infections. It is often used as initial induction regimen for serious fungal infections, and then is replaced by newer azole drugs. It is used as induction therapy, especially in immunocompromised patients, like people who are having severe fungal pneumonia, cryptococcus meningitis with altered mental status, sepsis syndrome as a result of fungal infection. So in all these cases, they are used. It has got broad spectrum of activity. That's why it is also used in case of mucormycosis, invasive aspergillosis, extracutaneous sporotrichosis, and cryptococcus as well. In blastomycosis, histomycosis, coccidioidomycosis, immunocompromised host or involving CNS. In all these cases, it's used. Again, in case of candidiasis, which can be in case of bones, heart, CNS, kidney, esophagus, peritoneum, disseminated disease. In all these cases, this can be used. In case of failure of other antimicrobial agents as well, in few selective cases, amphotericin B has been used. It has been used as a prophylactic in AIDS, cryptococcus as well, for cutaneous candida infection as topically, and the oral use to prevent the colonization of intestinal flora by candida, it has been used. So these are the different clinical uses. We can see that this is the drug of choice in certain cases, and it is an alternative in other cases, right? It is drug of choice in disseminated histoplasmosis, disseminated and meningeal coccidioidomycosis, disseminated and meningeal cryptococcus, invasive aspergillosis, and deep candidiasis, mucormycosis. Again, it is an alternative drug for blastomycosis, paracoccidioidomycosis, extracutaneous sporotrichosis. And this is preferred when mycoses are rapidly progressive and occur in immunocompromised host or involve the CNS. So let us look into the adverse effects. They are one of the highly toxic drugs. We said that earlier as well, right? And when given intravenously, they are very, very toxic. They may cause headache, fever, dyspnea, malaise, tachycardia, phthalatitis, and gout distress, right? And nephrotoxicity is one of the most common problem. Renal acidosis, potassium and magnesium ion depletion is seen. Azotemia is seen in almost 80% of the cases. That's why before you administer amphotericin B, you need to infuse 1 liter of normal saline. And hypochromic, normochromic anemia, mild leukopenia have been seen. Similarly, anaphylactic reactions rashes, diplopia, myalgia, convulsion, peripheral neuritis, they have all been noted. The resistance to aflatoxin B has been seen in Candida strains, right? But it is relatively rare. It has been reported in case of Candida krusei and Candida glabrata, in that increasing MIC has been noted. If the MIC is more than 1 microgram per ml, then we say that it indicates resistance to aflatoxin B, in that if we are to give a dose above this, it can cause very, very high toxicity to the humans itself. That's why this is considered a case of resistance to aflatoxin B. If there is defect in ERG3 gene, then this gene, which is involved in ergosterol biosynthesis, it will lead to the accumulation of other sterol in the fungal cell membrane, and this will also lead to the resistance. Consequently, pollen-resistant candida and cryptococcus isolates have relatively low ergosterol content, and then low ergosterol content will render them resistant again. Resistance to aflatoxin B may also be mediated by increased catalase activity with decreasing susceptibility to oxidase damage. We said that besides the leakage of intracellular contents via the pores that has been formed, right, aflatoxin B associated pores in the cell membrane, it is also that there is reactive oxygen species that is going to kill them, right? If there will be increased catalase activity, then there will be decreased susceptibility to oxidase damage. Nystatin is another pollen antifungal agent. Because this is not absorbed, it is also not absorbed orally, and it is not given IV because it is very, very toxic agent. Its mechanism is like aflatoxin B. It is ergosterol synthesis inhibitor. It is used for superficial mycosis of skin, oral, and vaginal candidiasis. Contraindicated parenterally. Talking about antifungal azoles. The antifungal azoles, they are synthetic compounds that may be classified either as imidazoles or triazoles. Right? Clotrimazole, oxyconazole, miconazole, econazole, tioconazole, and ketoconazole, they all fall under imidazoles. And there is a new drug called laliconazole, which falls under imidazoles. In triazoles, there is fluconazole, itraconazole, terraconazole, voriconazole, isavuconazole, posaconazole. These all fall under triazoles. You can see that antifungal azoles, they are used both topically and systemically as well. Right? Here you can see the structure of imidazoles and triazoles. So as I said earlier, imidazoles have got 2 nitrogen atoms in their structure, right? In the ring. And triazoles have got 3 nitrogen in the ring. That's why the name triazoles and imidazoles. Again, in case of imidazole, the position of the nitrogen in the ring should be like this, right? Otherwise, there are other cases like pyrazole as well, which have got 2 nitrogen, but then pyrazole and imidazole is because of the position of the nitrogen atom. If you remember the organic chemistry, the OMP position, then you can understand the position of imidazole. Likewise, there are quite many other azoles in therapy as well, right? We'll not be talking about the other azoles in therapy out here, but nevertheless, there are other azoles like albendazole and mebendazole, which are anti-albendic drugs, metronidazole and ernidazole, like anti-protozole drugs, and omeprazole, pantoprazole, rabeprazole, like proton pump inhibitors drugs, all fall under the category of azoles. So have a look at the mechanism of action out here. What you can see is that basically we said when we were talking about azoles, we said that they inhibit this C14 alpha demethylase enzyme, which converts lanosterol into ergosterol, right? It is one step in the conversion of lanosterol to ergosterol. And then because it inhibits this very step, it inhibits the synthesis of ergosterol, right? So ergosterol synthesis is overall inhibited, and thereby it interferes with the fungal cell membrane permeability, and there is selective action in that the drugs have more action in fungal cells as compared to the human cells. But nevertheless, what happens is that the specificity is lost if we use it in higher concentration. And imidazoles, the azoles that we saw right now, they have lesser specificity as compared to the triazoles. That's why they have got higher drug interactions and higher side effects. We see that When it comes to the drugs that inhibit ergosterol formation or inhibit at the level of ergosterol, there are three different drugs. If the allyl amines, right, which convert squalene into lanosterol via enzyme squalene epoxidase. Here, squalene epoxidase is inhibited by allyl amines, and then they stop the conversion of squalene to lanosterol, thereby accumulating the squalene. And again, this is the azoles, right, which stops the conversion of lanosterol to C14-dimethyllanosterol, and then there is amphotericin B and other polines like nystatin, which bind to ergosterol, form ergosterol associated pores, cause the leakage of the intracellular contents, right, and even the macromolecules, and thereby lead to cell death. Nevertheless, today we will be focusing about azoles, right? So it here causes the inhibition of C14 alpha demethylase enzyme, and this enzyme is very much similar to human cytochrome P450 enzyme. That is why the imidazoles they even cause inhibition of human cytochrome P450 enzyme when given in higher dose. Okay, so this is the prototype drug of the group azoles, right? So it is orally absorbed and has highest therapeutic effect among the azoles, right? It is therefore preferred agent for oral use, and it is the azole of choice when it comes to the treatment and secondary prophylaxis of cryptococcal meningitis. Because it has the CNS penetration of fluconazole is best among azoles, it is still used for secondary prophylaxis of cryptococcal meningitis, despite the fact that fluconazole was invented in 1990, and there are a lot many other drugs that have been invented after that. Okay, it is used in many other cases like candidiasis. There are various forms of candidiasis where fluconazole is used: oropharyngeal candidiasis, esophageal candidiasis, and even for the prophylaxis of candidiasis in bone marrow transplant, vaginal candidiasis, and candida UTI and peritonitis as well. When we look at the uses of various antifungal drugs, right, for various kind of superficial candida infection, we see that for oropharyngeal candida infection, fluconazole can be used, and likewise, nystatin and clotrimazole can also be used. When we are talking about nystatin, we said that they are used topically, right? So even when we are using out here, it seems that oropharyngeal is not too topical, isn't it? But then the thing is, nystatin will not get absorbed, so it will just remain in the GI tract and get excreted as such. So even the oropharyngeal portion, it's taken as if it's topical use of the drug. Then comes cutaneous in the candida infection, where itraconazole, terbinafine, griseofulvin, they are used, and cyclopyrox, haloperidol, naftifin, like other agents are also used. Then for vulvovaginitis, fluconazole is there, nystatin is there, clotrimazole is there, miconazole is there, all other drugs are also used. Let us have a look at the adverse effects. They are known to be relatively non-toxic, and the adverse effect is like, the most common adverse effect is GI upset. However, there may be abnormalities in liver enzymes. We already said that they also side-by-side inhibits the human cytochrome P450 enzymes. So the chances of them causing abnormal liver panel is there. And very rarely, it also causes clinical hepatitis. When it comes to using the drugs, the azole drugs for treatment of onychomycosis, what is done is that the pulse dosing idea is used. You know what is pulse, right? You've all noted what is pulse. So pulse dosing out here means you are going to give intermittent dosing of the drugs, so that you give a drug for 1 week and then you stop the drug for 3 weeks. This way, we are giving pulse dosing. Nevertheless, even while giving pulse dosing, the drug will persist in the nail for pretty long time, even several months. That's why it is effective as pulse dosing again, pulse dosing too. Okay, with respect to azoles, the resistance can be there because of the changes in the enzyme. We said that it causes the inhibition of C14 alpha demethylase, right? So if there is any change in the enzyme susceptibility, then this will cause resistance in them. And azoles, they differ in their affinities to the target, and this is the reason why they have a different spectrum of activity. In addition, there is variations in the structure of azoles, and because of this variation in the structure of azoles, like some have better spectrum of activity against some organisms. Nevertheless, cross-resistance pattern is also shared because of similarity in this structure. We are talking about the cross-tolerance when we're talking about individual drugs, right? So cross-tolerance will be there if there is chemical similarity. Similarly, cross-resistance is there if there is similarity in the structure among the drugs. Okay. So earlier we said that fluconazole was discovered and then like it was used for not many systemic infections, but then later on itraconazole was discovered. This is better than fluconazole in some aspect in treatment of few other diseases. But however, it has a huge potential for drug interactions, therefore it should be used cautiously. It is available as capsule and two solution formulations, one for oral and one for IV administration. It is the azole of choice for the use of dimorphic fungi. When we say dimorphic fungi, these are the fungi that take the structure of yeast as well and also of molds, right? Yeast are like single cell while molds are multicell, isn't it? So dimorphic fungi, they take both the structures like histoplasma, blastomyces, sporotrix, they are dimorphic fungi, and itraconazole, they can be used for the treatment of dimorphic fungi. It also has activity against Aspergillus species, but nevertheless, now voriconazole is the azole of choice when it comes to aspergillosis. It is used extensively for the treatment of dermatophytosis and onychomycosis. Dermatophytosis is all the skin infections, skin fungal infections, and onychomycosis is the nail infections, right? It is given in the dose 100 to 400 mg per day. Again, voriconazole is the new triazole that is available in both IV and oral formulations, and it is being used in other cases as well, like in aspergillosis, it is the azole of choice, right? Yeah, so there is more use of it. When it comes to the side effects, like the case of fluconazole, we said that hepatotoxicity can be seen in case of fluconazole as well, and even here as well, rarely it can cause hepatic failure and even death. So once you discontinue the drug and assess the liver function test, there may be dose-dependent inotropic effect which may precipitate congestive heart failure in patients with impaired ventricular function. So you should be careful when dealing with itraconazole in patients with cardiac problems. Okay? GI distress is less common at a small dose, like up to 200 mg. And like nausea, vomiting, hyperkalemia, increased serum mRNA transferases, rashes, they may be seen. And when given in higher dose, more than 300 mg BID, what happens is Advil is insubstantial may be there, lower edema may be there, hypertension may be there, and rhabdomyolysis may be there. Rhabdomyolysis means the breakdown of the muscles, right? And because of the breakdown of the muscles, the various components of the muscles, they are going to go to the bloodstream, and then they are going to lead to kidney failure as well in the long run. Phlebitis at the injection site has also been noted. Okay, now coming on to ketoconazole. Ketoconazole was the first oral azole drug that was introduced clinically, but then now it is recommended for topical use only because of its major side effect in the liver, hepatotoxicity is there. It is the drug of choice in case of graciofulvin resistant ringworm of the skin and also in case of tinea versicolor of the skin. We have seen the picture of tinea versicolor and ringworm earlier, if you remember. Right? In adverse effect, severe itching, burning or irritation may be there, or oozing may be there. Similarly, hair loss, oily or dry scalp, and eye redness is also seen. And in the oral forms, when it was used earlier, it could lead to menstrual irregularity, gynecomastia, decreased libido, and oozospermia, hypertension, and salt retention, and even teratogenicity. Why are we talking about the oral forms? Because though it is not used as antifungal orally, it is still used for its anti-androgenic effect in cases of advanced prostate cancer. Right? So for that reason, we are talking about the side effects of oral form. What you can see out here is that the fungal infection drug was banned in UK, right? And this news is there in 2013. Then again, this is an article which was published in 2015, which talks about the rise and fall of the oral ketoconazole. And then since 2011, ketoconazole have been under constant review, and then different countries, they have banned the oral forms of ketoconazole for treatment of fungal infection. Okay, now comes clotrimazole. Clotrimazole, we said that this is a topical azole, right? So the absorption of clotrimazole is less than 0.5 after application of intact skin. If the skin is intact or it's not broken, then the absorption is less than 0.5%. But however, if we are talking about the case of vaginal candidiasis, then the absorption may be there in the ratio of 3 to 10%. The fungicidal concentrations of the drug are known to remain in the vagina for as long as 3 days. And the small amount that is absorbed is metabolized in the liver and excreted in the bile. It is available as 1% cream lotion solution and 1 to 2% vaginal cream or vaginal tablets, like 100 to 100, 500 mg tablets or 10 mg trotches as well. When we say trotches, these are quite like lozenges, but they are meant to dissolve in the vagina very quickly. Lozenges normally don't dissolve, right? Whereas trotches, they dissolve almost instantaneously or very, very quickly. With regards to this clotrimazole vaginal tablets, there are many instances of patients taking the vaginal tablets as oral tablets because of improper consultation during prescribing the drug. And if it is just randomly prescribed to the drug and without proper explanation is not given to the patient, then there are many cases in which the vaginal tablets have been taken orally. Yeah, if like clotrimazole is, we said that this is supposed to be taken, to be used topically, isn't it? So it should not be taken orally and the effect will not be there. When the effect will be lessened, moreover. When applied on the skin, the applications are made BID or twice a day, right? The cure rates are relatively better when it comes to dermatophyte infections, 60 to 100%, cutaneous candidiasis, 80 to 100%, and even in case of vulvovaginal candidiasis, it's around more than 80% when 7-day regimen is used. Have a look into the various adverse effects of clotrimazole. In the skin, there will be a stinging sensation, erythema, edema, vesication, desquamation, pruritus, and urticaria. And when applied to the vagina, it can cause mild burning sensation, rarely lower abdominal cramps, and slightly increasing urinary frequency and skin rashes as well. Occasionally, in the sexual partner, there may be penile or urethral irritation. And when given by oral route, it can cause GI irritation. In patients using trotches, the incidence of the side effect is around 5%. Okay, now coming on to allyl amines terbinafine. When we said allyl amines terbinafine, we said that these are the drugs that are used in case of onychomycosis, right? So when we say onychomycosis, it is nail infection again. And we said that most of the older drugs that are used in case of nail infections, they require almost 1 year long therapy for relieving the toenail or nail infection of fungal, nail of fungal infection. So how does terbinafine work? It works by inhibiting squalene epoxidase, and thereby the toxic squalene will remain in the fungal cell, and this will cause the fungal cell to die in the long run. So terbinafine, it is a synthetic allyl amine, right? It's a systemic antifungal drug. It can be used orally for systemic infections. However, 1% cream is also available for topical use. It acts by interfering the synthesis of esterols in sensitive fungi. And like graciofulvin, it is keratophilic, but unlike graciofulvin, which is fungistatic, this is known to be fungicidal in nature. So this is the mechanism of action, right? The conversion of squalene into ergosterol is inhibited by inhibiting the enzyme squalene epoxidase. So there will be more accumulation of the toxic product of squalene, and this is going to lead to fungal cell death. When it comes to pharmacokinetics, it has good oral absorption, but however, the extensive first-pass effect, and therefore the bioavailability is only around 40%. It is 99% bound to plasma protein and accumulates very well in the skin, nails, and fats. CSF concentrations is around 10%, and half-life is 12 hours, but then this increases significantly to almost 200 to 400 hours at steady state concentration. Steady state concentration, we have talked about this when we were talking about the basic concepts of pharmacology, right? Steady state concentration is achieved after 4 to 5 half-life, like, and in that case, the half-life of the drug is drastically increased. It is not recommended to patients with azotemia or hepatic failure because of increased concentration of the drug. You can notice that with most of the drugs, it is going to cause hepatotoxicity, right? In case of amphotericin B, we said that this is going to cause, amphotericin B is going to cause nephrotoxicity, right? And apart from amphotericin B, most other drugs, they are known to cause hepatotoxicity. In case of azoles, it was the same thing. And now, even without terbinafine, there is the case of hepatotoxicity. Now coming on to therapeutic uses, the nil onychomycosis, right? 250 mg tablet OD is given, and it is at least as effective as 200 mg OD of itraconazole, and slightly more effective than pulse itraconazole therapy. The duration of treatment, it may vary from, with the site being treated, but typically is around 3 months. Ringworm elsewhere in the body responds well to 250 mg OD of terbinafine. Pediatric dose is not available, and it is said to be contraindicated in pregnancy. Typically, it should not be used as systemic therapy for onychomycosis in pregnant women, and it should be postponed until pregnancy is complete. For adverse effects, it is said that this is relatively well tolerated, and there is low incidence of GI distress, headache, and rash. Rarely, hepatotoxicity, severe neutropenia, and Stevens-Johnson syndrome or toxic epidermal necrolysis is seen. Like Stevens-Johnson syndrome is when the outer layer of the skin will start necrotizing and falling off. Right? So we call it toxic epidermal necrolysis as well, and Stevens-Johnson syndrome as well. Okay, now moving on to echinocandins. So when we say echinocandins, there are different drugs that were discovered in this group, right? Caspofungin, micafungin, anidulafungin. So what is echinocandins do? They act at the level of cell wall, right? So they are beta-1,3-D glucan inhibitors, right? So they inhibit the cell wall and thereby kill the fungal cells. So echinocandins, they are considered the newest class of antifungal agents to be discovered, and they are administered IV only. Caspofungin was FDA approved in 2001, right? These agents, they are active against Candida and Aspergillus. So all the uses of echinocandins will be there in case of Candida and Aspergillosis only, but it is not effective against Cryptococcus neoformans or the agents of zygomycosis and mucormycosis. Mucormycosis is one of the most difficult to treat fungal infections. Okay, so echinocandins, it acts on the fungal cell wall by inhibiting the synthesis of 1,3-beta-glucan or beta-1,3-D-glucan as well, we can say it. And it results in the disruption of the fungal cell wall, and fungal cell death is caused. The half-life of the echinocandins, they vary a lot, right? Caspofungin, it's around 9 to 11 hours. Micafungin, it's around 11 to 15 hours. And anidulafungin, it's 24 to 48 hours. As we said earlier, with all the echinocandins, they are used in case of Candida, right? And Aspergillosis. So we see that caspofungin is clinically used for disseminated and mucocutaneous candida infections, empiric antifungal therapy during febrile neutropenia. It has replaced amphotericin B for this purpose, right? In case of invasive aspergillosis, when amphotericin B therapy fails. Micafungin, it is used for mucocutaneous candida, candidial infections in case of bone marrow transplant. Anidulafungin, it is used for esophageal candidiasis and invasive candidiasis, including candidemia. Echinocandins, they are extremely well tolerated, so there may be only minor gastrointestinal side effects and flushing. However, elevated liver enzymes can be seen in case of caspofungin when given in combination with cyclosporine, so this combination should be avoided. Anidulafungin may cause histamine release during the intravenous infusion. Okay, can any of you name me the different agents that are known to cause histamine release? There are different agents that are known to cause excess histamine release during therapy, right? And they are often given with antihistamine drugs. Vancomycin causes excessive histamine release. That's why the term red band syndrome, right? The red man is because of excessive release of histamine, which causes excessive flushing in the person, and thereby we call it red man syndrome. So anidulafungin, vancomycin, and morphine, they are all known to cause excessive release of histamine when given. Okay, this is a chart, right, which shows the different agents and their indications. Okay, we've already talked about fluconazole, itraconazole, voriconazole. We talked about two drugs basically, voriconazole, posaconazole, isobuconazole. We have not talked about it. We talked about the caspofungin, micafungin, anidulafungin, and amphotericin B, right? So this is a chart that I made so that you guys will find it easy as to what are the uses of the various drugs. Okay, and this chart has been developed from an article called New Faces in Antifungal Therapy that was published in 2016. What you can see is that this is also taken from the same article. It shows the various infections and the drugs that are used in case of various infections, like in case of candida infections, can be treated with azoles, echinocandins, or amphotericin B, all as monotherapy. Invasive aspergillosis, the primary therapy is voriconazole, and alternative therapies can be amphotericin B, itraconazole, posaconazole, itraconazole, caspofungin, micafungin. Cryptococcal meningitis is often treated by co-administration of amphotericin B with flucytosine. In fact, flucytosine is never used alone because of its narrow therapeutic index and high toxicity. It is only used for cryptococcal meningitis with amphotericin B. Mucormycosis, amphotericin B, posaconazole, isobuconazole, these all are used. Coccidioidomycosis, itraconazole, fluconazole, amphotericin B, and prophylactic antifungal drugs like fluconazole, posaconazole, voriconazole, and micafungin, they are all used. Okay, let us have a look at other antifungal agents, right? Gracilfulvin. Gracilfulvin is a very insoluble fungistatic drug, and oral absorption, it depends upon the physical state of the drug. Fat-soluble vitamins, when they are taken with high fat food, they absorb better, right? So gracilfulvin is the same. It is well distributed and biliary excretion is seen. It is fungistatic in nature and it interferes with the microtubule function. It inhibits the synthesis and polymerization of the nucleic acids. What it basically does is it gets deposited in the newly forming skin where it binds to keratin and protects the skin from new infection. Therefore, the treatment with gracilfulvin will take a relatively long time in that the new skin that is formed will be devoid of the infection. It is not that the old skin will be rid of infection. Okay. It is used for various dermatophytes of skin, hairs, and nails. The side effect is headache, mental confusion, gut distress, photosensitivity, the changes in the liver enzyme function. It is also known to enhance the coumarin metabolism. Coumarin is associated with, it's linked with warfarin, right? So it enhances warfarin metabolism. Okay, the another drug is flucytosine. When we're talking earlier, we just said that flucytosine is relatively toxic drug, right? And the toxicity of flucytosine is because it's a pyrimidine anti-metabolite drug that is related to the anti-cancer drug 5-fluorouracil. So what happens with flucytosine is that this flucytosine is taken up by fungal cells via enzyme membrane permease. So this very enzyme that is present in the fungal cells will take flucytosine inside the cells, and this will lead to some sort of less effect on the human cells. However, again, if this is present in high concentration, then this can cause toxicity to the humans. And it is converted intracellularly to 5-FU, then to 5-fluorodeoxidine monophosphate and 5-fluoro and fluorouridine triphosphate. This in turn inhibits the DNA and RNA synthesis respectively. Human cells, they are unable to convert the parent drug to active metabolites, so selective toxicity will occur. And synergistic activity is seen with amphotericin B. When it comes to the clinical uses, it has got narrow antifungal spectrum, so it is used only for cryptococcus and candida albicans with amphotericin B. It is not used as monotherapy because the resistance will develop rapidly. So the clinical use of flucytosine is typically limited to combination therapy for the treatment of cryptococcal meningitis. The side effect is prolonged and high dose of flucytosine, it can cause reversible bone marrow depression, alopecia, liver dysfunction, anorexia, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, and skin rashes. It has got narrow therapeutic window with increased risk of toxicity at higher drug levels. And again, there is a problem of resistance that develops rapidly at subtherapeutic concentrations. So the therapeutic window is relatively small. With regards to the resistance of flucytosine, some yeast strains, they are intrinsically resistant to flucytosine because of impaired cellular uptake and secondary to the mutation of the enzyme cytosine permease. we said that for flucytosine to act, it should first get into the fungal cells, right? And there is the enzyme cytosine permease in the susceptible fungal cells, which will take the drug intracellularly, and then the conversion to its active form starts. So if the membrane, if the enzyme cytosine permease will mutate and will not allow the drug to enter inside, then the resistance will be seen. On the other hand, acquired resistance, it also results from the defects in flucytosine metabolism by mutations in cytosine deaminase and uracil phosphoribosyl transferase. That is, the activation-related enzymes, if they mutate, then again there will be resistance in flucytosine. However, the prevalence of primary resistance to flucytosine is relatively low, in that only 1-2% of Candida isolates and less than 2% of Cryptococcus neoformans isolates, they are known to be resistant. So let us start with sauterans. The sauteran family of compounds, what they do is they generally inhibit the protein synthesis in the fungi. And these are the only class of drugs that inhibit the protein synthesis in fungi. They do so by stabilizing the ribosome and elongation factor 2 complex. This is considered as a novel molecular target, in that no other group of antifungal agents, they target this ribosome and elongation factor 2 complex. They inhibit the translocation by stabilizing the elongation factor 2 ribosome complex, and they are known to have strong activity against Saccharomyces, Cerevisiae, and Candida albicans, and also a number of other pathogenic fungi. Sauterin, we said that this is a novel molecular target, right? But then the sauterin was first identified long before, in 1969 itself, in Switzerland, from Sauteria arenuniosa. The interest in sauterins was renewed only after 2 decades or so, in 1990s, that Candida albicans was being difficult to treat, and then this agent had caused potent in vitro inhibition of protein synthesis in Candida albicans, which was being a notorious pathogenic fungus. Okay, now let us come to cyclopyrox. Cyclopyrox oleomin, it is a synthetic broad spectrum antimicrobial agent. It has both inhibitory activity against the dermatophytes, Candida species, and tyrosine orbiculare. Tyrosine orbiculare is present in case of Tinea versicolor and also in case of seborrheic dermatitis, but it can be seen in both the cases. How cyclopyrox works is basically it binds to and kills the trivalent cations such as iron and aluminium ions. Thereby, it inhibits the availability of the essential cofactors for different enzymes. It is known to cause membrane instability by accumulating inside the fungal cells and interfering with the amino acid transport as well across the fungal cell membrane. It is available as 1% cream and lotion for the treatment of topical dermatomycosis, candidiasis, and tinea versicolor. Similarly, an 8% cream is available for the treatment of mild to moderate form of onychomycosis. The side effects are pruritus and allergic contact dermatitis. A combination of benzoic acid and salicylic acid comes by the name Whitfield ointment. This contains benzoic acid and salicylic acid in the ratio of 2:1, a 6% and 3% combination is there. And what it does is basically benzoic acid out here is fungistatic, whereas salicylic acid, it does not have any antifungal activity on its own, but then it has got keratolytic action. So the combination of benzoic acid and salicylic acid, it basically eradicates, benzoic acid helps in the eradication of infection, right, by fungistatic action, and then the keratolytic action of the salicylic, it helps extract the dead cells along with the fungus. It is also sometimes used in case of tinea capillis. However, the use is relatively less, in that it can cause mild irritation as a site of application. Okay, now let us move on to newer antifungal agents. The newer antifungal agents, some of them are already so much in use now, but then there are a lot many other drugs which are not so much in use. But nevertheless, by the time you finish your study in medicine after 5 years or so, these agents may be very much in use. So let us have a look. Isavuconazole, this is a water-soluble triazole prodrug, right? And it can be given both orally as well as intravenously. Isavuconazole, the prodrug comes as isavuconazium sulfate, And then when it is broken down by plasma esterases, it changes itself into the active component isobuconazole. Its structure confers activity against some pathogens which are inherently resistant to other azoles, even like itraconazole, voriconazole, and the newer agent, posaconazole. However, this isobuconazole, it is still highly active against all the Candida species, including Candida glabrata and Candida krusei. These are known to be relatively inherently less susceptible to other azoles like fluconazole. Isobuconazole also has excellent activity against Cryptococcus gatti and Cryptococcus neoformans. Then comes laliconazole. Laliconazole is a newer imidazole antifungal agent, and it is known to have potent activity against variety of fungi, especially the dermatophytes. Laliconazole is our enantiomer of lanoconazole, which is a residue mixture, and the R enantiomer laliconazole, it is more potent as compared to the residue mixture lanoconazole. Laliconazole, although it belongs to the azole group, it has got strong fungicidal activity against trichophyton species, so the activity is similar to that of terbinafine. Also, it has got favorable pharmacokinetic properties in the skin. So 1% of laliconazole skin cream was approved in Japan way back in 2005 for the treatment of tinea infections. Even in Nepal, the use of laliconazole for the treatment of dermatophyte infections has started. Further studies to evaluate the efficacy of laliconazole in onchomycosis are underway. So far, the most of the drugs that we talked about, they act on only the metabolically active cells. So here we are going to talk about novamycin, which acts on both non-metabolizing as well as metabolically the active cells. This is a potent synthetic antimicrobial polypeptide. It is a polyarginine-based cationic peptide, novamycin. Right? And this causes the membrane perturbation and lysis and kills both the metabolizing and non-metabolizing cells. The mechanism of action minimizes or negates the risk of acquired drug resistance. The mechanism of action that is specific only to the fungal cells and is non-toxic to human cells. It has got rapidly acting fungicidal peptide. It is a rapidly acting fungicidal peptide, and it has demonstrated superiority over the existing antifungal classes in preclinical testing for a number of fungal infections. It has been used for the treatment of aspergillosis as well as candidiasis. Another such agent is novixetine, which is also useful for both non-metabolizing as well as metabolically active fungal pathogens. It is also useful for both dermatophyte and non-dermatophyte fungi associated with onychomycosis. Novixetine remains stable and bioavailable within the nail for more than 12 months post-application. And the phase 1 and phase 2 clinical studies have shown that this is well tolerated and effective. And just 1 month of daily application is equivalent to other current treatments, which require up to 52 weeks of treatment. This is applied topically, and this is the first treatment of nail infections, which can address the underlying cause by killing the bacteria, killing the fungi, and rapidly improving the nail's appearance side by side. Okay, then comes Candida vaccine, the oral vaccine. Candida albicans, they express the immunodominant antigen called Inolase 1 or Inol1P. Saccharomyces cerevisiae cells that display Inol1P antigen on the surfaces, they have been generated, and the same cells like Saccharomyces cerevisiae cells have been orally delivered, and these engineered cells, they have been known to prolong the survival rate of mice that have been given Candida albicans. Candida albicans and Candida glabrata together are responsible for 70-80% of Candida infections in patients with candidiasis and candidemia. And because candidiasis and candidemia have become quite resistance have developed in Candida, that's why the search for vaccines started. The drugs that are still used for the treatment of candidiasis include caspofungin, micafungin, anidulafungin, amphotericin B, and even the azole drugs. Okay, this is a slide that talks about amphotericin B nanoparticles. the nanoparticles are just a new way of delivering drugs, and the future we'll be seeing more of drugs being given as nanoparticles, in that the magnetic nanoparticles help deliver the drug to the intended site of action. We'll not be talking about much detail out here. Then there is another class of drug called polyauxins and nicomycins. These are two class of nucleoside peptide antibiotics which are competitive inhibitors of chitin synthetase or the cell wall component chitin. They act as competitive inhibitors of the fungal chitin synthesis enzymes. It leads to the inhibition of separation, chaining, and osmotic swelling of the fungal cell. The nicomycins were characterized earlier in the 1970s itself as metabolites of Streptomyces tendi. Nicomycins are competitive inhibitors of chitin synthesis, right? And they have been most extensively evaluated for their activity against coccidioids emitters. Why coccidioids emitters? Because this is a fungal pathogen which has got very high chitin content in them. One member of this group, Nicomycin Z, had been found to be highly effective in the treatment of coccidioidomycosis in animal models. Because the spectrum of activity of Nicomycin is relatively limited, it got less attention in the research. Even the polyauxins, it was first reported in 1960s and isolated from Streptomyces cacaoi. And nicomycins, they have displayed synergistic activity with some azoles and glucan synthesis inhibitors or the echinocandins as well. But Candida albicans have shown resistance to polyauxins mostly due to poor transport through the cell membrane. Modification of this are needed to produce drugs of clinical value, and this has failed for a long, long time. Nicomycin, they just came out after 2015 or so. Okay, have a look at this chart. This chart shows the fungal infection causing agents as yeast, first categorized as yeast, molds, and dimorphic fungi, right? Which dimorphic means they show the characteristic of both yeast and molds at different times. And these are the different drugs that have been tried. And this shows the spectrum of different drugs against yeast, molds, and dimorphic fungi. This picture is quite like the same old picture, right? Except that the newer picture replaces the old drugs, full antifungal drugs, right? Some of them have come into the clinical use, but then most of them are still under clinical studies. When we're talking about antifungal drugs, we said that amphotericin B is inherently nephrotoxic, right? And apart from that, many other drugs are known to be hepatotoxic. So we can see that terbinafine, itraconazole, gracilfulvin, fluconazole, they are all hepatotoxic, and thereby liver function tests should be carried out with most of the cases. Okay, this is a summary of antifungal agents that has been taken from the book Katzen, right? So you guys can have a look at this summary. Once you go through all this lecture, this summary chart is going to help you revise everything we just talked about earlier. This is a chart that shows the different formulations of different antifungal drugs that are available in the market. This slide again shows the different toxicity of the drugs for you guys to remember, right? Like hepatic toxicity is seen with all azoles, amphotericin B, 5-fluorocytosine, and echinocandins. Renal toxicity is classical picture that is seen with amphotericin B. CNS toxicity and eye toxicity is seen with voriconazole. Cutaneous toxicity or rashes and photosensitivity can be seen with voriconazole again. GI toxicity can be seen with itraconazole, posaconazole, and 5-fluorocytosine. Cardiac toxicity can be seen with itraconazole. Amphotericin B and echinocandins can cause infusion-related reactions by causing the release of TNF-alpha and interleukins. 5-fluorocytosine can again cause bone marrow suppression. This is keeping all the side effects together. Okay, these are the new antifungal agents. Again, they may be in the market after 5 to 10 years. This is just for you guys to have a look. Nicomycin Z, it has already come to clinical use somehow, and others are still under study. Okay, that is all for today. Thank you. Have a great day.